the uniqueness of Christ in history. You can come to this academically by looking at the New Testament documents and showing how they have withstood the onslaught of critics or any kind of analysis across the centuries. You could look at this from the perspective of missionary movements and see how it is many parts of the world have been conquered by the message of Christ, and that too would be quite unique. But I would like to look at this from the very person of Christ and try to set that before you in your thinking. The fact of the matter is, ladies and gentlemen, that the name of Christ has been virtually unique and unparalleled in history as the one who claimed in himself to be the locus and the sum and substance of the answer. Not just only in what he said or what he taught, but in himself, so that if you remove Christ from the Gospels, there is no gospel message left. He is the central feature of his own message. He was born in an obscure village, the child of a peasant woman. He grew up in another village where he worked in a carpenter's shop until he was 30. Then for 3 years he was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never traveled 200 miles from the place where he was born. He did none of the things one usually associates with greatness. He was only 33 when the tide of public opinion turned against him. He was turned over to his enemies and went through the mockery of a trial. He was nailed to a cross between two thieves. When he was dead, he was laid in a borrowed grave. 19 centuries have come and gone, and today he is the central figure of the human race and the leader of mankind's progress. All the armies that ever marched, all the navies that ever sailed, all the kings that ever reigned have not affected the life of man as much as that one solitary life. 20 centuries later, critics have not been able to obliterate him. Contrary views have not been able to smother him. And somehow, within the deepest recesses of the human heart, for millions of people in this world, the name of Jesus Christ still brings the concept of hope and the reality that there must be somebody out there who put my 2 feet on this earth and with a reason to give me some hope. He was the meekest and lowliest of all the sons of men, yet he spoke of coming on the clouds of heaven with the glory of God. He was so austere that evil spirits and demons cried out in terror at his coming, yet he was so genial and winsome and approachable that the children loved to play with him and the little ones nestled in his arms. His presence at the innocent gaiety of a village wedding was like the presence of sunshine. No one was half as kind or compassionate to sinners, yet no one ever spoke such red as heart-scorching words against sin. A bruised reed he would not break. His whole life was love. Yet on one occasion it demanded of the Pharisees how they were expected to escape the damnation of hell. He was a dreamer of dreams and a seer of visions. Yet for sheer stark realism, he has all of our self-styled realists soundly beaten. He was the servant of all, washing the disciples' feet. Yet masterfully he strode into the temple, and the money changers and hucksters fell over one another in their mad rush to get away from the fires they saw blazing in his eyes. He saved others, yet at the last himself he did not save. There is nothing in history like the union of contrast which confronts us in the Gospels. Sir Stuart, the mystery of Jesus is the mystery of divine personality. Now would you listen to a secular voice, the voice of the great historian W.E.H. Lecky. The character of Jesus has not only been the highest pattern of virtue, but the strongest incentive in its practice, and has exerted so deep an influence that it may be truly said that the simple record of 3 short years of active life has done more to regenerate and soften mankind than all of the disquisitions of philosophers and all the exhortations of moralists. End of quote. And the New Testament scholar F.F. Bruce, responding to Lecky's comment, said this: "That is a non-Christian, or at least not distinctively a Christian judgment of one sense in which Jesus is not only a historical figure, but also our eternal contemporary. His influence lives on." Why is it? What is that uniqueness? The great English professor C.E.M. Jode used to be on the airwaves quite often and used to be asked a lot of questions. And he had a brilliant way of responding to many a question, and he would begin his answer with these words, "It all depends on what you mean by." So when we look at the theme, the uniqueness of Christ in history, let's ask the question, it all depends on what you mean by the uniqueness. Does it mean that there is nothing in Christ that you, or his message that you will find anywhere else in some fragmentary form? No. But it does mean that in him there is such a consummate expression of God, and in his message is the totality of the expression of what we need for salvation and life. Listen now, please, so that anything that contradicts it becomes untrue by definition of the fact that he claimed to be the truth. So either he is false or that which contradicts him is false. There may be hints of truth and ideas that are in other systems, but the consummate expression in Christ is so geared towards truthfulness in an absolute sense so that anything that contradicts it ipso facto becomes false. But as I look at the uniqueness, I want to give you five ways in which Jesus is unique. First is his eternal perspective. His eternal perspective. The Bible says, "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." The son is not born. The child is born. The son is given because the son eternally existed. He prays in his high priestly prayer, "Restore to me the glory, Father, that I had in your presence before this world was made." The Apostle Paul says, "Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon himself the form of a servant," which means he pre-existed the form that was presented in his earthly manifestation. He is the only creature in existence as part of the Godhead, the reason for whose existence is in himself. Every other creature looks for the reason of its existence outside of itself. We are all contingent, caused, and finite. God alone is infinite, uncaused, and has the reason for his existence in himself. What does that do for us in looking at his uniqueness? It points to the reality of heaven, which is the heart's deepest longing. It really doesn't make sense, does it? "Who thought it not robbery to be equal with God," the eternal I Am, who came into this tiny little world created by his own utterance, as it were, who could talk to us of the glories of heaven. One day I am longing to listen to a whole sermon on heaven. I don't have the capacity to give it the analogies. So I'm borrowing a paragraph from C.S. Lewis, who talks about heaven in one of his writings in his own inimitable way. Listen to it, and listen to it again when you get back in your minds. In speaking of this desire for our own far-off country, which we find in ourselves, even now I feel a certain shyness. I'm almost committing an indecency. I am trying to rip open the inconsolable secret in each one of you. The secret which hurts so much that you take your revenge on it by calling it names like nostalgia and romanticism and adolescence. The secret also which pierces with such sweetness that when, in very intimate conversation, the mention of heaven becomes imminent, we grow awkward and affect to laugh at ourselves. The secret we cannot hide and cannot tell, though we desire to do both. We cannot tell it because it is a desire for something that has never actually appeared in our experience. We cannot hide it because our experience is constantly longing for it. And we betray ourselves like lovers at the mention of the name heaven. And Jesus Christ, in his embodiment, points to the glorious heaven, which was his home. How unique for someone to come from the glory of heaven and tell you and me, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I have told you earthly things and you do not understand it. How are you going to understand heavenly things? There is no analogy, yet we cannot hide it in our experience. It keeps on suggesting it. But not only does his reality point to the reality of heaven, please notice now, he fuses every moment of history with meaning. If he is transcending over time, if he is the eternal I am, and always is ever present, our eternal contemporary, in the words of F.F. Bruce, then the fact of the matter is, he fuses all of time with significance. You look at Jesus with his band of few disciples at the table. He takes a piece of bread and he breaks it and he says this, as oft as you shall eat of this bread and drink of this cup, now you do proclaim the Lord's death in the past until he come in the future. He fused every moment of history pregnant with meaning that God gives to it. If I were to ask for one sermon that I could have listened to live, it would be tough, wouldn't it? This great transtemporalization idea, where he transcends the temporariness of past, present, and future and gives it all meaning. But if you could transport me and say, Ravi, I'd like you to listen to one message live as portrayed in the Old and the New Testaments, which one would you take, Ravi? Oh my. I could think of Elijah on Mount Carmel. I could think of Peter at Pentecost. I could think of Paul on Mars Hill. And of course, that sermon of all sermons, the greatest of all sermon on the mount. But I think as I have weeded through, I don't know if I'm in error, but I've latched on to the one I would love to have listened to live. As those two disciples on the Emmaus road in Luke 24 are walking and talking despondently of all that went wrong, we had hoped he would have been the deliverer of Israel. And as they're walking, this third personage joins them. They don't know who he is. And he says to them, what are you boys talking about? And they say to him, are you the only one in Israel who does not know what has happened? Ironically, he was the only one in Israel who did know what had happened. And the Bible says, then he unfolded the scriptures and showed them all from beginning of the prophets, all that had to come to pass. And they say how their hearts burned within them, so that as the time came to part, they said, I'll buy you your dinner. Would you sit down and continue talking? And in a masterful stroke of the beauty of the Word of God, it wasn't some great exposition at that moment, but when he simply took that piece of bread and broke it, their eyes were suddenly open and they saw the entire panorama of his history through the eyes of the Eternal One. Jesus Christ continually contradicts us in the way we experience ourselves as alive, and he compels us to radically redefine what we mean by life. He encounters us the way he encounters the disciples on Easter Sunday. They were the ones marked out for death. Those who had survived him were really the dead. He, the dead one, was really the living. He continually contradicts us in the way we experience ourselves as alive. The American football coach, Lou Little, he was a college football coach, one of the greatest, talks of the time that one of the young men on his team was an outstanding young man in character, but never quite made it to the top spot. He was always a backup, a bench warmer, as they called him, a great young man. And Lou Little says, many times I'd see this young man walking his father through the college property. His father's arm would be in his son's, and the son would be talking to him about the buildings or explaining some piece of architecture or painting. And he said, they seemed to be so close as dad and son that I never quite got to the point of introducing myself and breaking up that closeness. Until one day I got a call from his mother saying, Coach Little, my son admires you an awful lot. He feels very close to you. His father has just died a few moments ago. Will you please help my boy get his plane ticket, put him on the plane, and send him back for the funeral? Coach Little did that. On the day of a game, the young man flew back. He said, Coach, I want you to do something. Would you please do this for me? I want to play the game tonight. I know I'm not the first stringer, but I want to play the game tonight. Coach said, I can't let you. He said, but I tell you what, if you play better than the man whom you're replacing, I'll leave you in there. If you're not playing as well, I'll have to take you out. He said, that's fine. He went and played and by far was the star of the game, gave it an effort and a half. And when it was over, the coach put his arm around this young man's shoulder and said, "I know what's happened. You played that for your dad, didn't you?" He said, "Yes, coach, but I want to tell you something. My dad was born blind. And this was the first time he was going to watch me play." He did not come to set up a political power that would rule and constrain from without. He came to touch the hearts of men and women that would bring the imperative from within. And what a world of difference that is. Jesus did not come to set up some political structure in this world. Politics swings from one end to the other. And political ideas almost become like that drunken man moving from one wall to the other, knocking itself senseless with every hit. He did not come to change humanity by establishing an earthly government or some political strategy. You see, politics inevitably moves towards power. And Lord Acton has rightly said, power tends to corrupt and absolute power corrupts absolutely. He came instead to touch your heart and to touch mine. And that's why Napoleon said it, "Alexander's kingdom and my kingdom will ultimately come to naught, but Jesus's kingdom is indestructible because ours was dominated by power and force. He's dominated the lives of people with the power of love." He changes us from within. There was no pressure, just that gentle tug. This is right. This is the right way to go. You know, Jesus could have yielded to political temptation. When the devil said to him, "Turn these stones into bread and they'll follow you," he said no. The marvelous thing about him was he did not want to draw people by feeding some earthly appetite of theirs. Every leader sooner or later finds out that self-centered appetites are insatiable. You can never satisfy the one who wants more and more and more bread and the things of this world. He works from within. A man who had lost his life in alcoholism, a medical doctor, who marvelously came to know Christ. And one day when he was sitting in his doctor's office, a friend came to him and he said, "Let me ask you something. Please tell me. I'm trying to explain what's happened to you, trying to explain it away as a fellow medical colleague of yours. Tell me something. We're all trying to understand you. What's happened? Is it a psychological uplift you've received? What is this?" And you can answer it by telling me this. "I know how you were hooked on the habit of liquor. Tell me, if you were to come back to your office some afternoon after a miserable day of all that's gone wrong, and you shut that door, and you know you're alone, and nobody is there with you, are you telling me with that finest bottle tucked away behind your medical journals, if you had one, you're not going to reach out and take that drink once more, even though it'll bring back all the memories of the past and your enslavement? Are you telling me, with a miserable day, locked behind closed doors, nobody with you, you're alone, you wouldn't yield to that?" He said, "No, every contingency you've given can at some time properly happen, except one. Since I have come to know Christ, I have found out I am never, ever alone. I came to know Christ on a bed of suicide as a teenager in Delhi. All the religiosity from without had done nothing for me. All the power my dad wielded in the political arena had only alienated me because I was no longer important to him." I say that kindly because God marvelously changed his life down the line too. But I just want you to know this, how he entered a hospital room and touched the heart of a young man with the gentleness and a wideness of his mercy. As vast as this world is, and as vast as this world was, Christ had time for the individual. His message is personal. In this cosmic scheme of things, in this cosmic scheme of things, I say to you, how marvelous to know that he has time for you and me personally. What is there in man that you are mindful of him, or the Son of Man that you have visited in him? For when I see the heavens and the work of your hands, the moon and the stars which you have made, what is there in man that you are mindful of him? But yet as he walked through that village with the masses, he got talking to this woman who had been married 5 times, rejected by many people evidently, who was immoral in the sight of society, and in that society being a woman was even more rejected in a very gender. Her ethnicity was against her. She bore that horrible term called a Samaritan, which was a scourge in that time, despised by the so-called pure. There she was, morally, in her femininity, in her ethnicity, all of those rejections. And she runs back to her village and she says this, "You'll never believe what happened. I have met somebody who knew everything about me and didn't hang me up by a cord," is what she's trying to say. When a death sentence was passed on a man for writing a book against the that seemed to mock that religion, a very foolish thing to have done, gets nobody anywhere. Do you know the story, how the death sentence was passed on him by the Ayatollah? And it was interesting to listen to a newspaper man or Ted Koppel on Nightline say to this professor, "Tell me, how can you pass the death sentence on an individual like that? All right, he's been blasphemous, he's been wrong, but you really want to take such vengeance into your own hands?" And the man looked at Mr. Koppel and said, "Sir, in what I believe and what we believe," I don't know if he's representing all of them, but this is what he said, "the individual is dispensable. It is a system that has to survive. The message has to go on. The individual is dispensable. I couldn't help but think of the parable of Jesus where the shepherd left the 99 going looking for the one, because the individual was not dispensable." The story is told of an American politician who was talking about the victimization of some people, a minority class. And one day a young teenager from the minority class came to him because he knew this man was giving speeches, creating bumper stickers, writing placards on the needs and the rights of the minority. And so this young teenager went and met up with the politician's secretary at the door and said, "Can I go and see him for just 1 minute, please? I need 1 moment of his time. He's delivering a great speech today." And the secretary went to his boss and he says, "There's a teenager. He wants just a few moments of your time." The politician said, "Tell him I have got so involved in his cause, I don't have time for the individual anymore." And the secretary paused and said, "That is incredible, sir. Even God has not come to that stage yet."